Konnichiwa. Today, we're going to talk about some new tools and tricks that will really help to streamline your use of Japanese. Some you may know already, one, the most important one, you probably don't know. And that is a completely new approach to AI translation. Now, I don't recommend the overuse of translators, but there are some use cases in learning Japanese that have been pretty much marginal up to now because Google Translate is really so inaccurate, particularly with Japanese. Well, the whole situation has changed, and I'll talk about that in a moment. First of all, let's talk about ways of using the Japanese IME, the input mechanism, to make life easier and do some things that seem pretty much impossible unless you know how to go about them. First and simplest, if you want to force katakana when you're typing on a Windows keyboard, all you have to do is press Alt plus Caps Lock, and that puts you into katakana. Control plus Caps Lock will put you back into hiragana, and as you probably know, Shift plus Caps Lock toggles between hiragana and romaji, so you don't have to switch keyboards every time you want to type English versus Japanese. We talked a little while ago about Japanese quotation marks. If you're typing in kana, which I recommend, it's easy enough to get the regular quotation marks. If you're typing in romaji, it can be more difficult. But the simple way to do it is just type kakko. And if you do that, you'll find that various kinds of brackets, including single and double quotation marks, come up along with the kanji suggestions. Those suggestions aren't just there for kanji. They can do all sorts of things, as we're about to find out. For example, if you want to get that Japanese wavy dash, which is important in Japanese because a long dash looks the same as the vowel extender mark used in katakana and occasionally hiragana too. So to get the wavy dash, you just type dash, and you get a variety of dashes, including the wavy dash. How do you get exclamation marks and question marks in Japanese again? This is very easy. You don't have to switch in and out of the romaji keyboard. You just type hatena, and that will give you a question mark. Hatena is the usual Japanese word for a question mark. Or bikkuri, and that will get you an exclamation mark. And the more you use these, the IME is quite smart, and it will promote them up the list of characters. So if you're using them a lot, you'll probably find you just have to type ha or bi, and you'll get the question mark or the exclamation mark near to the top of the list. Now, I do recommend typing directly in kana, and I've done a video on how to do that, but this doesn't matter whether you're typing in kana or typing kana via romaji. Either way, it'll work. It'll also work on mobile devices if you're using Flick input or if you're unfortunately typing via romaji. If you want to get the null sign, the sign I use for zero pronouns, which almost nobody seems to know how to get from attempts to reproduce it in the comments, you just type kushu, and you'll get among the suggestions for that our zero or null sign that we use for the zero pronoun. If you want to get circles, often a double circle is used to represent a missing word or a word that could be any word. You just type maru, and you get all kinds of circles, including those double circles. If you want numbers in circles, which are often used in Japanese for enumerating things, really the simplest thing is just to type the number, ichi, ni, san, etc. And among the suggestions will be that number in a circle. You may have to scroll down a bit to find it. But again, if you're using it often, it'll work its way up the list of suggestions. Now, there are lots of other fun things you can do if you want to with the IME. For example, if you type hoshi, you'll get various kinds of stars, including black ones, white ones, and colored ones. If you type hato, you'll get various kinds of hearts. If you type yajirushi, you'll get arrows of various kinds pointing in all directions. And if you type kawamochi, you'll get a whole variety of Japanese kawamochi or emoticons, which are quite fun to browse through. And you can experiment yourself with other words and see what you get. Lots of interesting things tucked away in that IME. Alright, now we're going to talk about the thing that's revolutionized artificial intelligence translation. It's free, and it's called DeepL. Just look it up on Google, or if Google's tried to block the competition, look it up on DuckDuckGo. As I say, I don't believe in using translators too much, but there are occasions for using them. For example, if you're writing something in Japanese, now I do recommend using the database approach for doing this, and I'll link that above my head because it's a very important technique for writing natural Japanese, and a translator doesn't help you around that. I don't recommend typing things in English and seeing what the translator does. What can be useful is that when you've made your sentence in Japanese and maybe you're not quite sure about it, run it through a good AI translator and see if it understands what you're saying. See if it comes up with pretty much what it was you were intending to say. And DeepL is much better for this than Google Translate. Why? Well, frankly, I'm not sure how people manage to program translation in Japanese when all they've got to go on is the fuzzy concepts of Western Japanese grammar, as we find in textbooks and also in academic papers. DeepL seems to have stumbled on something closer to real Japanese structure, and it works a lot better. It's also a lot more au fait with Japanese ways of putting things. Google Translate often comes out with complete errors or with over-literal translations that say pretty much what the Japanese is literally saying, but not what it actually means. Now, there are times when DeepL is perhaps too sophisticated for its own good and comes out with very colloquial things or clever guesses that aren't exactly right. So, if you're going to use this, I would go to DeepL first. I'd also cross-check with Google Translate if you need to. It's much more pedestrian. It's not generally as accurate, but it can give you a cross-check on DeepL. Using the two in conjunction, with DeepL as definitely the leader of the two, this can be a handy technique for just finding out if what you said is what you meant to say. You will still get false positives, but it is an important tool along the way. If you have any questions or comments, please put them in the comments below, and I will answer as usual. I'd like to thank my Gold Kokeshi patrons, my producer Angels, who make these videos possible, and all my patrons and supporters on Patreon and everywhere, and everyone who likes and comments on these videos, and everyone who watches them, and of course you, for attending this lesson. Let's go on working together to improve our Japanese the way DeepL has improved the entire field of artificial intelligence translation. I was quite interested that it was called DeepL. It's obviously a reference to Google's DeepMind. So that's quite a daring challenge to throw down. And I'm very happy to see that the challenge is justified and that for all Google's money and research and power, the rebels have for once defeated the empire. これからもよろしくお願いします。Class dismissed.